are now being rationed by the companies on how many masks and gloves they can get.
Wow.
So you know what's happening on the, Mike was just talking about, he was in line for, you know, the line was going out of the store into the parking lot. So there is a lot of concern. I wouldn't call it panic right now, but it is a mild sense of panic that people are trying to stock up. But the important thing is, I'm not sure they realize what they should be panicking about, and that is to keep from giving the virus to yourself. Keep your hands out of your face. Keep your hands out of your mouth. Make sure you sanitize your hands as best you can, because you must pick up the virus from a surface and transfer it into your body. And if you don't do that, you won't get the virus. And I don't think that's being put out there strong enough. Mm-hmm. People are just panicking. They think, and you know, they put masks on kids. My son teaches school in Singapore, which is right next to China. And he says that they're telling them that the parents, they tell the parents, it's not important. Don't put masks on your children because it won't help. Parents are doing it anyway. And he's saying, he goes out in the parking lot, and what did, I'm on the playground, and what do the kids do? They take the mask off and put it on the ground.
Oh, wow.
And then they run and play. And then when they finish, they pick it up off the ground and put it back on their face.
Wow.
Oh, Lord.
It works. And that's what, you know, because they're kids.
Yeah.
And so the parents are doing them a disservice by trying to protect them, but they're not giving, you know, the message about them putting their hands on something dirty and then putting it on their face. They're doing the exact opposite as they're intending to do. So that's why I'm stressing to people that, you know, keep watch your hand. You, the only way you're going to get it, and if somebody coughs down your throat or you put your hands on a surface that has the virus and then puts it in your nose or mouth. So
wow.
If you prevent doing those things, you'll be much safer.
Wow. And just want to remind.
But in terms of travel, mm-hmm. in terms of travel, the president of your United States has taken credit for the slow dissemination of this disease because back in, you know, in the early, in the beginning of the year or last year, he banned people flying to this country. But you can see what's happened on the cruise ships.
Yeah.
You know, they're quarantining people. So travel, I would say at this point, should be a well thought out decision that you and your family make, whether it's worth traveling to an area like if you're going to Asia or something, or now, like you said, it's spreading all over. Like now it's Europe, it's Southeast Asia,
right.
You know. So I would say that, you know, if you have to go to those places, just make sure, and you don't know what kind of products they're going to have, make sure you have your sanitizers with you, your wipes and stuff like that, so you can best protect yourself.
Well, I'm glad you said that. And, you know, Dr. Audrey, one of the things that you're seeing to have happen now is that same discussion about should I go to this place and should I go to that place? At what point should we consider, okay, I'm not going to go to Gold's Gym. I'm not going to go to my fraternity dance or the Jack and Jill thing or the Walmart even. Are we at that point or should people start thinking about some of the places that I should avoid until they get a handle on this thing?
Well, I would avoid a lot of public places with a large gathering of individuals. Look at the gym. How do they clean the gym? The gym's not regulated. Gyms and certain areas, places like that, aren't regulated by the government. They aren't graded like a restaurant where you can go and you get a grade A passable. Think about all the surfaces, sweat, blood, skin, people coughing, exercising, exertion. Just think of what's happening when you go to a gym, certain public places.
Well, you know, that's a great point. And as you were saying that, I was thinking about some of those MMA fights. Depending on where you sit in the arena, you can actually feel sweat and other body fluids, you know, flying throughout the air and getting on the audience and so forth. So, you know, you raise a great point. people, would you recommend people consider not attending these events or at least watching them on TV until they get this under control?
I will watch it on television. Also, you need to think about the engineering aspect. How is the air circulating in these buildings? How is the air and air circulating in airplanes? How is the air cleaned? How do they do it? And people need to take all that into consideration when they're in such a close contact, closed-in area. What is the ventilation like? As I can tell, when I work, when there's no air circulating in the office, I begin to cough. I can tell personally just being in certain buildings where there's no air and there's no airflow. So people need to take all that into consideration. What's at work? What's going to happen at work? Schools? How is the air? How is the air? How are the buildings maintained? There are a lot of things to take into consideration when you have a virus that is passed by droplets, touch, how they sanitize. You see on television, they're spraying all these areas, sanitized. You can't disinfect it, but they're doing the best they can. But you have a lot of areas, and public areas are being sanitized. So basically, you need to, like, good hand washing, but also you need to stay healthy. You need to eat a healthy diet and keep yourself healthy. Because remember, a lot of the cases, a lot of the individuals have pre-existing conditions. People with heart disease, respiratory disease, they have pre-existing conditions. So they're going to be more susceptible to the virus.
Right. That's a question when you talk about where people either quarantine or they curtail their travel or their appearances in public. When you say until you get a handle on it, if there's no vaccination for this thing, there's nothing that's going to come up this year, how do you get a handle on something when there's no vaccine for it as of yet, other than just people? I mean, is it when the weather changes, is something going to be different, or how, what's going to make, what makes it, when you say get a handle, how do they get a handle on it without having any kind of medication that's going to be ready for a year?
I can take a step of that. And that is, like we said, you got to prevent from giving the virus, to ingest the virus yourself. And it's been made very clear that the virus is only affected. It only affects your lungs, which means for it to get into your body, it can only come in through your mouth or through your nose. So that if you don't touch or if you sanitize surfaces and prevent them from getting into your body, you're safe. You will not contract the virus. And that's the take-home message, that there's no need to panic if you just ramp up on keeping your hands out of your face and mouth, keeping your hands sanitized to the best of your ability. You're going to prevent yourself from getting this virus, because we know that once you get it, depending, like the doctor said, on you, how strong your health is, how good your immune system is, you know, if you're already sick, then you're going to be more susceptible to a lung infection or respiratory infection. So the important thing is to keep yourself from contracting the virus. And if you can do that, as far as we know, that's the only safety net you have.
Wow. Well, we certainly appreciate that. And just to remind our listeners, we are talking about the coronavirus with Dr. Eugene Albright from Riverside, California, and also Dr. Sharon Audrey from Washington, D.C. And they've been giving us some great information. And when we get back, we want to talk a little bit more about some of the precautions, some of the more vulnerable communities, and just some other things that they recommend that every one of us can partake in that may keep us a little bit safer and help us from losing our minds as the officials are trying to work through this thing. So keep it locked. We'll be right back on Straight No Chaser. You're listening to Straight No Chaser. We'll be right back.
DWI, even at first, it's pretty harsh. You don't realize, you know?
Up to 90 days in jail.
Can't be there for my family.
I'm in here. They're out there.
They put an ignition interlock in your car for 1 year.
Car won't start unless you blow into it.
It's embarrassing.
You gotta pay fees. Get a lawyer.
Need to see my probation officer for testing all the time.
Have to pick up garbage.
It literally consumes your life.
I lost my family's trust.
Lost my job.
I lost my marriage.
I lost my kids.
Lost a lot of time, you know? A DWI is just a big waste of time.
I just remembered it's election day. Are you going to vote?
I don't know. I don't think I'll have time today.
Millions of eligible voters in America never make it to the polls or even register to vote. When you don't vote, you're letting other people make decisions for you and pick the things your taxes will pay for. Voting is more than a civic duty. It gives you a voice about the priorities and the future of your community and our nation. Voting gives you a seat at the table.
Leave me alone.
When a child shares hurtful comments online, that's bullying. Visit erasebullying.ca to learn how to help your child stand up to cyberbullying.
I always wanted to be just like my dad. Well, maybe not always.
Children who witness domestic violence are two times as likely to abuse their children and partners in the future.
Only 34% of people injured by intimate partners seek medical care.
Destroy the middle, it's a waste of time.
What do you think you're doing?
I'm leaving. I can't do this anymore.
What makes you think you can do that?
One in three women and one in four men have been victims of domestic abuse in their lifetimes, but there is always a way out.
Call 1-800-799-7233 if you or someone you know is a victim of domestic violence.
Let's get back to your girl, MBZ, Pastor C. And the Chief, as they give it to you straight, no chaser.
We are back from the break. And again, we are here with Dr. Eugene Albright and Dr. Sharon Audrey. And they are helping us to work through this whole coronavirus situation. As I said at the beginning of the show, I was at the Costco this morning with this afternoon, with my wife, and we decided we'd get out there and start getting things based on what we were seeing on the television. And of course, as we got there, there was a line going through the store, out the back into the parking lot, circling out on the freeway, and everyone's baskets were full of water and hand sanitizer and bleach, hand wipes, you know, everything that you can think of to clean. The shelves are literally wiped out. I'm talking about bleach, detergent, hand sanitizer, soap, liquid soap, powdered soap, you know, fabric softener, everything you can think of that people use is literally flying off the shelves. And the bottled water is literally non-existent. There's just a lot of things that are flying off the shelves as people, I guess they think that they're preparing for dealing with this thing. And I'm assuming, and I'm going to throw this to the doctors, I'm assuming people are preparing to shelter in place, because I can't imagine